Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, I want to thank you for these stories that have been shared to encourage one another, that it was a very traumatizing experience, and yet you were with us. I pray that God, this will teach us like the Holocaust teaches the Jews, that it should never happen again. Unfortunately, evil people still live. And I pray that we will choose the option of showing people love around the world instead of hate. Lord, just be with us and help us to do the right thing. And I pray that as I bring your word, just give me what your people need. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. I think the previous 3 weeks, I have been encouraging you to take a look at our young people. Take a look and decide whether we're going to invest in them or not. Take a look and begin to see where our future is, whether we are just going to just abandon them and say, oh, it's their fault. We don't, it's their fault, they don't want God. Instead of being flexible to listen and to figure out ways by which we see how they think so we can help them. Listen, if you don't know how the person thinks, you can't help the person. You can propose anything thinking that that can be the answer, but you can be wrong. You need to know, we need to go into their minds to see where they are so we can bring them home. So brothers and sisters, from time to time, you begin to see that I will never leave it to rest. So if you don't hear much about it today, I'm moving to other aspects of our life and our walk with God. So the topic for our meditation this morning is intimacy with God. Be intimate with God through what? Through prayer. Be intimate with God through prayer. What does it mean? Well, as the sermon unfolds, begin to pick what fits you and begin to see what your intimacy with God should look like so that you can walk with God in a way to tap into all the blessings of God. You know, John Wesley prayed a prayer. I'll read to you. And I want you to carefully listen to and begin to see that you could be one of them, or you can opt to be one of them. He said, give me 100 preachers. 100 what? Preachers. Who fear nothing but sin, which means they don't fear a giant, they don't fear a machine gun, they don't fear anything in the world, they don't fear a lion, they don't fear a bear. What they fear is sin. And desire nothing but God. And I don't care a straw whether they be clergymen or clergywomen or laymen or laywomen. He says, such alone will shake the gates of hell and set up the kingdom of heaven on earth. Whoa, what a prayer. 100 people who fear nothing but sin. Let me tell you something. If you want to go closer to God, you have to know what God doesn't like. And the number one thing God doesn't like that made Jesus come to die to fix that problem is sin. The whole problem in the scripture about what God, what upset God most is sin. But in today's world, oh, everything goes. Everything goes. So the problem is this, that we clearly can't see where God is. And we are trying to figure out where God is. We are like in the dark, trying to figure out God. And yet, it's very simple. Stay away from sin. Who can go ascend to God's holy mountain? Psalm 24 tells us, they are the ones who have pure heart, clean hands, and don't deal with idols. Jesus told us in the Beatitudes, only the pure in heart will see God. So if you are dancing with sin, let me tell you, God's grace is working around you. Don't want to tear you down, but you are driving God away from you. And if you can fix the problem of sin in your life, then the next thing is that you want more of God in your life. You desire nothing but God. He said, these are the people who will shake the kingdom of hell. All the sinful nature that is in the world, they will pray to tear them down and establish God's rule. Because let me tell you, if you will stay away from sin and your desire is to know more and more of God, when you pray, God, zoom, God, come quickly. Because if you read Isaiah 59, verse 1 and 2, it said, God's hand is not short that he cannot save. His ears are not dull that he cannot hear. But sin has separated us from God. Friends, God wants people whose desire is to stay away from sin and cling to Jesus Christ for righteousness. So John Wesley said that those who fear sin and desire more and more of God, they can pray to change the world. Whatever situation it is, they can change it through prayer. And actually, if you look at it, that is the foundation for intimacy with God. You want to be intimate with God? Then the foundation is fear sin and desire God. But in real life, when we say that people are intimate, at least there are some few characteristics that I can bring to your mind. Those people who are intimate with each other, they communicate. They talk to each other. True or false? True or false? They don't talk to each other and they are intimate. Oh Lord, have mercy. They are always together. All right? They want to be together in Las Vegas. They want to be together in where? Tell me all the exciting places in the world. They want to go. They want to be happy together. They cannot leave each other. You are work, oh, you have to call. Even if they will fire you for calling, you see them still calling because they can't stay without their intimate partner. And they touch, right? They do everything to be so close to each other. They are intimate. Can't we transfer this with our relationship with God? Can't we imagine how our intimacy with each other can be changed to God? Today, two words I want you to keep in mind and think about. Intimacy with God, intimacy and prayer. I've had some couples who are married, but each one have his room and her room, his bed and her bed. would they be really intimate? If you're in another room and he's another room, you actually breeding room for corruption. So you don't see what I'm doing, I don't see what you are doing, and you are intimate, it doesn't work like that. Of course, I can understand that, you know, the other will be nagging you so much that, you know what, the best way is to sleep in one room, let me sleep in one room. Because they will come, oh, you did it because you didn't buy me the French fries. I was hungry. It's possible. I was hungry. If I had had the French fries, my skin would be smooth. My face would be smooth. My eyes would pop out. And it's past. I can buy you tomorrow. Then, you know what? I don't want to hear. Because meanwhile, I'm thinking about getting the millions and be buying island for you, and you are nagging me with French fries, you know? When you are thinking about big ideas, small ideas, you know? And that's what, so you know what I don't want to hear? You'll sleep in one room, let me sleep in one room. But the idea of intimacy is that each one want to be where each other is. You don't want to be with nobody but the one you are intimate with. And can you think about it and be intimate with God? That will help. The other one I want to think about is prayer. Be intimate with God through prayer. And what is prayer? We have made it complicated, but it's very simple, friends. It is simply talking to God. You can open your eyes. I have gotten used to closing my eyes when I'm praying, so I want to stop, but I can't stop. But if you think, open your eyes will help too. Prayer is simply asking God and receiving an answer. Matthew 7:7 tells you. It's simply asking and receiving. And Him 492 will tell you, prayer is the soul's sincere desire, whether uttered or never expressed, whether you say it or you don't say it. That is, prayer is the soul's sincere desire. Friends, let me tell you, you walk around with two personalities, two persons in you. One is this body, one is the soul. The soul never dies. The body will die. Unfortunately, we pay attention more to the body and we forget about the soul. The soul needs to be intimate with God, friends. Because the day God created Adam and breathed into his nostrils, God, part of God entered human beings. Human beings are the only one God gave the charge to take care of the world. Human beings are the ones who are next to God. Actually, we are higher than angels. Someday we're going to judge angels. God has made us so high. And the psalmist asks, with all that you have done, why are you so mindful of human beings? And yet human beings are so dear to God. And when God put Adam in the Garden of Eden, he will come for fellowship with them. All right? God will come to the garden and they will have fellowship. So you begin to see that God created you so he can have fellowship with you, friends, to be intimate with you. So until they disobeyed, that when God was coming, they were running away. God's plan was that they have to be together. He created humans for himself. Unfortunately, we have developed our own way of trying to see God, and it doesn't work, friends. You see, prayer is Christians' vital breath. The soul, if the soul will breathe, it needs prayer. So if you have not been praying, you have been starving the soul. If you have not been cultivating the art of praying, the soul is dead. is just merely hanging on something like, what it needs is you to pray. Prayer is how you stay closer to God. And in the passage that you read, so much was in it, and I know if I go through, time will, but I will take the last verse of Mark chapter 1, verse 35. I want you to pay attention. It reads, very early in the morning, after all, Jesus has healed the sick, driven away demons, and done so many things, and he came to sleep. Very early in the morning, the scripture says, while it was still dark, when nobody was up, maybe if you put the time, it could be between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m., right? When everybody was sleeping, right? Jesus left the house. Maybe they were sleeping in Simon Peter's house. So he left the house, went off in a solitary place, a quiet place, where he prayed. Listen, many years ago, somebody told me, if you are not a good tailor, or you want to learn how to do tailoring or a seamstress, you don't know how to do it, nobody's there to teach you, you take a dress, right? You put in a paper on the cloth and you cut around it and you sew it like that and it can become one, right? You don't know how to, but what you have, you put around and that's it. If you want to be a man, a woman that will be after God's own heart, then do it the way Jesus did. Again, listen carefully. In the morning, a great while before it was day. Because you know something? When you get up in the morning, then, somebody calls your friend, oh, you know the dream I had? Lions were chasing me, huh? And, oh, yeah, can I bring my kids to you, or can you bring my kids to you? And the news on the TV and all the stuff that is going around, when are you going to have quality time with God? It is important that you feed the soul, my friend. If your mindset is not on feeding the soul, you are walking dead. You are walking dead. You think you have life, but you are dead. Prayer is the soul's sincere desire. We can give everything the body needs, but if the soul is not feeding, you are walking dead, my friend. And Jesus showed us the way, that early in the morning, while it was still dark, he got up, left the white, and he went to a solitary place, maybe a wilderness, a desert, a place where nobody was. And he began to pray, to talk to God. People don't realize that if your mind is divided around God, God already knows. I remember George Washington Carver. He is the one who revolutionized a Greek in the South. They were planting cotton and all, and the soil was getting badder and badder. And George Washington Carver said, you know something? Plant legumes. The crops that will take nitrogen from the atmosphere and fix it in the soil. So that if you do the rotation, yes, whilst cotton will take it, the legumes or peanut will bring it back. And now they planted, they did it and it was working. Now a peanut was all over the place. If you went to fight, that's what they would beat you with in the South. And they were confused. So what do? We don't know what to. George Washington Carver will leave the house early in the morning, around around 4 a.m. and he will walk through the woods, the forest, and he said, talk to me, earth, talk to me, talk to me. What do I do? What, talk to me? And let me tell you, God is not sleeping. God heard him. The way the product that eventually George Washington Carver brought out of the peanut, hundreds of inventions that came out of peanut. You think that when he was walking there, not by himself talking, it was aimlessly? No. Friends, if you want God to draw near to you, show that you're interested in drawing near to God. At dawn, when everyone is sleeping, friends, get up and talk to God. Get up and talk to God. And you begin to see that you will be so much at peace with yourself and with God. You will begin to see that, seriously, you will love everybody. Hate will be out of your life. You begin to see what you can do for God and God's ministry to thrive and grow. Some of us, the only prayer we will hear much is when we come to church. Right? That's all. We just, oh, God, help me do this. No. God wants quality time with you. And anytime you spend quality time with people, the friendship develops, it grows, it deepens. Think about God as the one who created you, who has all the power to change every situation, my friend. You want to ignore him and think you're going to do better? Of course, sometimes we achieve some level of success and we think, of course, God can make you go higher if you are praying and developing intimacy with him. And he prayed. One of the things I want you to learn or to hear before we go is this, that we should find time for ourselves to pray. And I'm asking you, what time do you pray with God? You set that time. Not that when you are rushing out of the home, oh God, take care of me and go, da, da, da. God knows you are going, God will take care of you. It's not when you are eating, oh God, hey, bless this food and that may be all right. Yeah, God will bless it for you. But really, where do you feel that you want God's attention? Where do you, have you all the 24 hours? What part of the 24 hours have you cut that I want to sit down with God and have a conversation about my family, about my friends, and everything that interests me? Friends, when is the time that you pray, you sat down and remember that Brother Richard talked about his sister with cancer, Carol Cook, right? That you got up and you say that this concerned me and you pray for her, him. Or you pray for her. Even though he might not see you, you are actually coming closer to God because God sees that you care. When did you pray for Brenda? Huh? When did you pray for the sick in the church and those you know, or Mary Bell in the situation that he finds herself? When? We always love to talk about them, all right? But have you set a quality time that you sit with God and said, God, do something? If it's all about that, I should say, you are wasting your time. Because I am limited, and all of us are limited. But do it in such a way, do it in such a way that nobody will see except God, who will reward you, and you yourself will be closer to God. When did you get up to pray for this congregation? If there are challenges and problems, when did you do that? Jesus got up early in the morning to a quiet place where he engaged God. And it's ironic that Jesus, you are God, right? Do you need to talk to God? Huh? Do you need to pray? If I were Jesus, I know everything, I'm not going to pray. But he was fully human, he was fully God. It's a mystery that it will never happen in the world except in Jesus alone. Fully man, fully God. Who can be like that? That's why he could die on the cross to save us. So when his human side can, oh, you don't have money for this, you can't do this, you can't do that, the human side will be pulling. And he knew the only way he could have money for this, he can get healing for those who are sick, that he can pray for, is to go to God. Friends, you are fully human. You don't have God. Okay, God breathed into you, so there is some God in you, but you are not like Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, and yet see what Jesus was seeing. There's a man called, George McCloskey. He had a life. When he married, he decided that he would set one hour aside to pray for his children so that they would know Christ. Now, as the children were coming, he started adding them. Great-grandchildren, he was adding them. You know what happened? The family that were coming, the two girls they had, all married pastors, their great-grandchildren, four, a woman, one girl, boy became a pastor, they all married pastors, and you begin to see that the descendants were becoming people who were working for Christ. Because this man set aside a time that he will pray for 1 hour for them. I need to come back to this sermon. But friends, here we are as people of God, journeying with God. The greatest tool God has given to us to survive in this world is prayer. It appears that Christians are talking and acting more than we are praying. United Methodist Church ministries are like near collapse. Everywhere you go, the pews are empty. I know that this time, because of COVID, some are online. But listen, the same story is everywhere. We think that if we do this and we do that and we do this, it will be okay. But it actually makes us happy. And if God, we are not praying about it, it is our own thing. It's not God's. And us, someday it will not last. But if God is in it, it will last. So friends, whatever you are doing, don't trust your mind, your intellect, and yourself. You have to figure out a way that I want this to live. I want this to grow. But I need God to make it happen. Okay? And therefore, you begin to see that after a while, things will change. God will bring more and more and more and more people. God is the one who builds his church. We are instruments he uses. But never say that, God, follow me. God, follow me. I know better than you, God. All right? Don't ever do that. Say, God, lead, let me follow. So if you believe in that, you pray about everything you do in the church. This church must return to a place where we pray. That's why tomorrow, starting from tomorrow, we are going to be online. I believe Sydney has sent you the invitation. Please, if you are not working, those who are working, listen, go so that you can bring your tithe to God, okay? I want you to go. But those who are not working at home, please come online, write your prayer, say something. Let us change this congregation through prayer. It will happen. Things that we never dreamt of will happen. We will go beyond whatever you ever want it to be. And we need to set big goals. I don't want to have, next week when we meet, yes, we're going to talk about it. We need to set big goals. We don't say, oh God, let us grow. No, look, how do we measure it? Do we want 100 people to be here? 200 people to be here in a year's time, in 2 years' time? Let us write them down. Let us pray and move towards it. Don't let us be just there. Because if we set higher goals and we are praying, God will make it happen. Because after all, God is the master builder. We are talking about young people. Listen, if we are not shoring up with prayer, no matter what good ideas we have, it will not last. I am telling you, if you have challenges in your life, no matter what it is, God is bigger. And if you can build intimacy with Christ and begin to talk with God, everything will come together. May God help us. May God help us and open our eyes to see that the more we don't pray, we are losing. And that we can commit to God through prayer and develop real intimacy with God as we see God move into our lives and blesses us. Let us pray.